Hello everyone! In this video, you'll get to know the basics of the new path nodes in Substance Designer, what they can do, and how to use them. Alright, so what are paths? You can think of them as basic vector files encoded in the color pixels of a bitmap. For each path, at least 2D vertices is stored, and they are linked together by line segments. Like vector graphics, they do not depend on resolution, and they can be resized without loss. So what can you do with them? If you've watched the introduction to splines, you know that their main use case is to be, well, converted to splines. You can generate paths from a grayscale image, convert them to splines, then use those splines to produce any effect you like. Scatter patterns, map textures, fill shapes, and so on. You can think of them as a link between masks and splines. Now, before we begin, I'd like to remind you that tooltips are here to help you along the way. You can display them by hovering over the nodes as well as over the parameters themselves. Please check them out whenever you're unsure what the slider does or what kind of input a node is expecting, and so on. Before you start using Path, make sure you have the right setup for it. When you open Designer, go to Edit, Preferences, then go to the Projects tab. Here, make sure you have Engine V9 selected for the compatibility display. Also, if you're used to working with in-context editing, it's a good idea to turn it off for performance reasons. Just go to Graph and untick Enable Graph Editing in Context. It should be disabled by default. All right, let's go over the nodes themselves. Like splines, they are a separate category of object and are not meant to be used directly in your graph. They come with their own tools and modifiers. There are 10 path nodes, but you'll be mostly using these two, so we may as well start here. We have mask to path and path to spline. These nodes are pretty self-explanatory. They will provide you with splines based on an input mask. So say you have a grayscale image, such as this one, and you wish to trace the contour of these patterns in order to place stitches, for example. All we have to do is get our mask to path node and connect the image to it. As soon as we do that, a funny color preview shows up in the 2D view. Each color represents a different path, and just like with splines, you can isolate certain paths by using the Select Path node. Now, if I want to see what path I'm selecting, I can't just double-click the node like I would normally do with ordinary nodes. See? What is currently displayed is the path data stored in these pixel lines you see here. If I want to actually see the path, I need to use the preview node to get a similar display as the one we saw before. This preview node is very useful as path nodes normally don't have any preview output, so you'll find yourself using it quite a lot when working with path. Let's just increase the preview thickness so that we can see better what we are doing. Here we go. Now I can go back to the Select Path node and just cycle through the various paths generated with my mask. Awesome. I can also select paths based on their length, which proved very useful in this case because, as you can see, it allows me to isolate the inner part of the pattern. Now, before going back to the mask to path node, let's just take a step back and go over this preview thing one last time because I know things can feel a little confusing at first. So we have our mask here that we can easily display in the 2D view. And then comes these three path nodes that all look blank at first sight. The mask to path does have a preview, but as long as the preview output is not used, it will not show in the node's thumbnail. And I have to double-click the preview output to see it in my 2D view. Then comes the path select node. This one has no preview built in, so I have to check its result using the preview path node. Now this one only looks blank because of the transparent background. If I check it in the 2D view, here are my paths. All right, now that we've set this straight, let's go back to our mask to path because we have a few interesting parameters to cover. Double-clicking the preview output. All right. The default parameters should work fine in most cases, but you'll sometimes need to adjust them for specific results. A smooth mask does a blurring pass on your mask. You can see how it rounds the corner of my pattern here. It can be especially useful if you have a hard black and white mask, but in our case, we don't really need it, so I'll set a pretty low value to get the sharp corners back. As for the mask threshold value, you can think of it as some kind of offset slider that covers the grayscale range of your mask. If you have a very hard mask with no smoothing, it won't do much, but in this case, it helps me placing the path just where I want it. Be careful not to go for extreme values, as it might break your path. If you take a very hard mask, for example, and try to offset it to the max, you might get these artifacts as the algorithm tries to close the shape. You can fix that by disabling the close open path option here, or by avoiding extreme offsets. Finally, the decimate path slider controls the path resolution. You can set it to 0 if you want a high fidelity result, or push it to the right if you want a more optimized path. Okay, so say you're happy with your path and you want to use them directly as splines. To do so, just take your path output, not the preview, the path output, and plug it into the path to spline node. This node comes with a precision slider, but be careful with this one. You should leave it untouched unless you have a specific need for it. It will change the output size and can get quite heavy. The default 2048 format works fine in most cases. And voila! Now you can run the result through any spline node and have a fully mask-driven spline setup. In the case of this material, I have split the short path and the long path into two different streams thanks to the path select node. I then converted both of these into splines that I was able to handle separately. I could choose to scatter sequins on the first batch of splines and pearls on the second one. Let's now go quickly over the remaining path nodes. They let you adjust and modify your path, and even create them from scratch. The path polygon node, for example, generates an optimized path from a primitive. It's especially useful if you want to explore how paths are built in the first place. With the path 2D transform, you can, well, move, rotate, and scale your path, while the quad transform lets you deform it using four handles. There's also a warp tool for path. And like the spline warp, which displaces the whole spline, the path warp acts only on the path's vertices, which you can display in the preview node, by the way. So depending on your path resolution, you will get different results. Finally, the path vertex processors are two advanced nodes that let you interact with your path vertices. Please note that these nodes are also meant to be taken as examples should you wish to build your own custom path tools. Path can do a lot if you're willing to get your hands dirty, but it goes beyond the scope of this tutorial, so if you're interested, stay tuned for more advanced resources on the topic. You now know everything you need to get started with Path. We hope this taster has inspired you to try it for yourself, and we're looking forward to see what you create.